Welcome back to After the Fact. So your host, Christian Esguerra, joining us now is former Comelec Commissioner Louie T. Tuguia and the Elections and Inclusion Expert, May Gladys Butoy. Good evening, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Our pleasure, Christian. Good evening.
Okay, today we're going to talk about a very important issue that is often overlooked during elections, the abuse of state resources, basically taxpayer money, by mostly incumbent officials running in the next election. So we're seeing it now, a few months before the 2022 elections. Okay, I'd like to start with Attorney Aguia. What does the law say about candidates in an election using state resources, primarily because they are incumbent officials?
Okay. If we look strictly at the law, it says that any person who uses under any guise whatsoever, directly or indirectly, public money or public funds, or any uses printing press, radio, television station, audiovisual equipment operated by the government or any of its subdivisions and other instrumentalities, government-owned controlled corporation, armed forces of the Philippines, or any equipment, vehicle, facility, apparatuses, paraphernalia owned by the government or any of its political subdivision is prohibited. So you cannot use all these things for partisan political activity or election campaign. But then again, Christian, when you say election campaign and partisan political activity, we have again this limitation about who can be liable for partisan violating the rules on partisan political activity, and that is where the issue of candidacy being that which starts during the start of the campaign period. So yun again, yun na naman yung issue dito. But the law is very clear. However, outside of the campaign period, I think there is no law that allows the use of public funds anyway for personal campaigning of a sitting elective official. So that can be classified perhaps as malversation if public funds are used, for instance, or if government facilities are used for personal promotion of someone who has filed the certificate of candidacy, even if it's not yet campaign period. So it might probably not be an election offense, but it can be an violation of our anti-graft law. So yun siguro, that is the, I think, yung kabuuan ng abuse of state resources.
Okay, in short, we're not exactly, meaning taxpayers, we're not exactly without any recourse in terms of going after these candidates for obviously using state resources. Is that it? Kasi para lang mas maintindihan ng mga nanonood. No?
We are not without any recourse, yes.
Yeah, because the frustrating part here is that a candidate cannot be considered a candidate officially until the start of the campaign period officially.
Unfortunately, that's the
okay. That is also
election.
That is also the argument used why there's no such thing as premature campaigning. Anything goes before February. And then I think, February and March, is that correct?
February 8th for national position, meaning president, vice president, and the Senate, and the last week of March for a local official.
For local, okay. I'd like to ask May, okay. Basically, help us understand, May. What do you mean by inclusion expert? First, inclusion, what do you mean by that?
Hi, Christian. Good evening. So inclusion means I'm working on electoral and political issues that involve marginalized groups, making sure that they are able to participate politically and electorally. So we're talking about persons with disabilities, indigenous peoples, persons deprived of liberty, and also in the context of COVID, that means ensuring that everyone, including those who might be having restrictions in their mobility, are able to vote.
Okay, we've heard the dilemma laid out by Commissioner Tito Louie T. Tuguia. Now, by experience, is there really a way to actually stop or at least just minimize this abuse of state resources by incumbent officials running for elective positions in the next elections?
So I think the way to look at it is through the eyes of civil society. Because if the law is not very clear and it's and the legal framework actually does not really provide you with enough enough to regulate the abuse of state resources, then you look to civil society organizations to monitor these abuses, report about it. Also, the media has a big role in talking about the abuse of state resources, bringing the attention of citizens to these issues of abuse of state resources in elections, which is a form of political corruption, really, where you know individuals and groups abuse their powers over government, financial, and other resources.
So basically, you can name and shame them.
Yeah, remember the EPAL campaign and then the law that didn't pass on the EPAL. I think the EPAL campaign was very effective in calling out the candidates who had the temerity to put their faces on everything, including the smallest projects to the bigger projects.
Okay. Also, to help our viewers better understand this, May, Why is it not supposed to be done, this practice of using state resources, our money as taxpayers, for the self-promotion of candidates who happen to be also incumbent officials?
Yeah, so the abuse of state resources in elections is really a huge problem for electoral integrity because it creates undue advantage to candidates who have power over government, financial, and other resources. So the other resources we're talking about are institutional resources. So for example, what was mentioned already, if you're using physical infrastructure or government vehicles or civil servants, that's considered institutional abuse of state resources. And then you also have regulatory powers abuse. So for example, when certain incumbent officials would not issue campaign permits to their opponents, that's an abuse of their regulatory powers. And the use of state-run or state-controlled broadcast media and social media accounts to promote certain candidates is also one form of the abuse of state resources. So that those things create undue advantages to candidates who have control over those resources. And on the other hand, there's also the right of voters that the abuse of state resources basically tramples on. So if, for example, you're using your power as an incumbent official to intimidate voters or to prevent other candidates from campaigning, then you're basically denying the right of voters from being informed and from freely choosing their candidates.
Okay. Commissioner Gia, basically, how do you draw the line between, let's say, an incumbent official simply promoting a government project and him promoting himself while latching onto that promotion of the government project? And how do you draw the line? Or is it even possible to do that?
Well, first and foremost, it's the principle behind it. I mean, elected public officials are supposed to do their job, and they do not have to, to advertise themselves by simply doing what they are supposed to do. There's nothing really great about doing what they are supposed to do. In other words, you see a lot of billboards supposedly to advertise projects and all these things, but you would notice that the most prominent portion of the billboard would be the face or the person of the image of the politician. So to me, that is nothing but a way to advertise oneself. For another one is when you do distributions of relief goods or you do ayudas. No, these are usually done by your people on the ground who are supposed to distribute all these things. But again, you would have to go there and maybe spend public money to use airplane to go to a place just for you to be present, stay there for maybe 30 minutes and have the media take a photo of you. That's abuse of state resources. And maybe ang daming ganun eh. Government does not stop during election, but you know, you have to distinguish between what things that may be necessary and things that are not.
Okay, again, you also made it clear early on na until the start of the campaign period, you cannot go after them in terms of an election violation. But you can also go after them in terms of possible graft or malversation. No? Okay, I'll start a very concrete example. Again, this practice, this abuse of state resources can be done by the opposition or the administration. But of course, if you're talking about the executive department, basically that's the administration. Okay, I'll cite a very concrete example. Does this fall under that violation that you're talking about, Commissioner Gia? For example, during the regular laging handa briefings over Radyo Pilipinas, I think formerly that was called Radyo ng Bayan, you would notice any reasonable person could see that there is excessive or even perhaps unwarranted exposure provided to Senator Bongo, who is now running for vice president. Does that fall under that violation that you're talking about? The use or if not abuse of state resources?
Well, if I have to analyze that situation, then I would ask the question, is Senator Bongo really necessary in that announcement? Because, you know, you have to make announcement, you have to inform the public, and you have to go do this regularly. But is he really someone who would be, who must be there? Or is he someone who you cannot conduct the briefing without his presence?
Actually, his presence is not the issue. There's always a news report about him quoting him, helping victims or helping the poor, providing ayuda.
Well, honestly, that would be a gray area because if it's a news report are not considered, use of public resources, even if you use a government facility. But repeated reference to a particular candidate and only him alone, then that can tread or that can tread the gray area or even, you know, amount to something that is already abused if you do it repeatedly. Yes.
So in general terms, you don't have to say that vote for this guy or this guy.
You don't have to do that. I mean, you know, promoting one's candidacy need not contain or did not be accompanied the words vote or not vote, you know?
Okay. Let's cite other examples. May, you can also chime in on this, no? Baka sabihin naman ng mga supporters, sa mga supporters, si Senator Bongo, na we're singling him out. Okay. Again, as I mentioned earlier, this violation can be done both by the opposition and the administration. For example, in the case of, let's say, opposition senators, let's say, kunwari, si Ms. Ontiveros, o kaya si Kiko Pangilinan, going around, how would you know whether they're using their own money or donations and not using the money that you're getting from their salary as a senator in going around? I mean, isn't that also a gray area?
Well, so I think you actually hit the critical point there. If the source of the funds that they're using is the state resources, then you can start exploring if it's actually an abuse of state resources. And then you can also look at the intent. Why are they going around and why are they plastering their faces all over what they're giving away? For example, I don't know if they're actually doing that, but so look at the source. Are they using state resources? Second, is there intent behind it for promotions for their candidacy? But like Commissioner Gia said earlier, the role of government doesn't stop during elections. But are these people necessary to actually deliver those services themselves? So you have to ask those questions. You have to be critical of those actions and actuations.
Attorney Gia, what I'm trying to drive at here is that is there a problem with the law not able to adjust to the realities on the ground? Because an argument may be made that it's very hard to police these people. For example, can you actually determine whether Senator Manny Pacquiao, Senator Panfilo Lacson, Senator Tito Soto, Mayor Isko Moreno, Vice President Len Robredo, that when they go around during the election season, they're not using government resources to fund their travels, etc., etc. Or Bato de la Rosa and Casey is indeed campaigning, or also Senator Bongo. I mean, how do you deal with this when everybody can do that?
Actually, when they use state resources, there would have to be some report somewhere. It has to be reported to the COA, so that should appear. No, and if they did not use it, and maybe they have used their allowance, and that is something that would have some kind of a paper trail as well. And what we are saying actually is that, you know, when incumbent politicians, whether from the opposition or from the administration, if they do something that would require some cost, then that should be a red flag for someone who might be monitoring use of state resources. And I think the burden is on this politician to explain that what they are spending, if it's a campaign or if it's a personal campaign, is their own money. So I think there has to be a demand for more transparency insofar as incumbent officials are concerned. The basic thing about abuse of state resources actually is that, you know, it's fairness. And you would want your opposition to adequately challenge the incumbent. That's the principle behind this. And this is the same principle that governs the same abuse of resource advocacy and laws in other countries as well. You want the opposition to have equal opportunity to challenge the incumbent. So that's the essence of it. So but I guess, yes, sorry.
But the legal provision itself, is there something wrong with that?
Yeah.
Does it need fixing or tweaking?
And, you know, and the basic problem with us is that, you know, our this is a 1985 provision of the Omnibus Election Code. Again, one of the antiquated provision. It has not adapted to the current political realities on maybe on how, you know, politicians and even voters and even, should I say, bad actors in elections game the system. So we have to really revisit the legal framework of election, especially the provisions in our election code pertaining to the use of money in politics in general. And one way to do this, and there were, is to, you know, strengthen maybe political party, because if you institutionalize political parties and then resources for campaigns are centralized or coursed through political parties, then regulation of even the use of state resources can be better monitored, because that's how it's done in other countries. It's usually the political parties that are held to account because they have a strong political party system.
And the taxpayers can contribute to the political parties.
Well, that's it. And the contribution can even be monitored and regulated by the audit department, or okay, in our case, COA.
May, earlier you mentioned the important role of civil society. How else can civil society and the rest of the public reasonably police instances where incumbent officials abuse, not just use, state resources for their own campaign?
I think that's a very good question, because I wanted to make that point that there's really no community of practice, like an organized community of practice around monitoring the abuse of state resources. And I think it's important that we build that community among civil society organizations and citizens to monitor the abuse of state resources in a systematic manner, the way that campaign finance, for example, has been monitored systematically. Because when we monitor the abuse of state resources and raise awareness about it, then the citizens can actually hold their candidates to account through the vote also.
Okay. May Gladys Butoy and former Comelec Commissioner Louis Tito Guia, thank you for joining us tonight on the program.
Our honor. Thank you, Christian.
Thank you for having us.
Maraming salamat po. Okay, now before we go, social media has become a war zone as dueling hashtags emerge following the disqualification bid against Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. Some netizens use the hashtags Laban Marcos Jr. and Protect Marcos Jr. as they voice their support for their presidential candidate. But critics hit back at their move by launching a similar hashtag, this time urging the people to protest rather than protect Marcos, and also protect the Philippines from Marcos. Meanwhile, swarming opinions continue to proliferate online. Commission election spokesman James Jimenez says the poll body will likely raffle off petitions to cancel COCs of 2022 candidates, including the petition against Marcos by Monday. So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.